Welcome everyone to Heroes of Cards 4. We're going to have a pretty sweet tournament for you guys. We got the GBG set. We got Frodan as the other caster. How you doing?
Doing alright, Crit. How are you today?
Doing pretty good. And we got a pretty cool lineup of players. The tournament format this time around is going to be a little bit different. We're running basically single elimination. We're going to have four set of matches today. We're basically going to see all the players. The ones that win are going to show up tomorrow. And the third match of tomorrow is going to be the final, the grand final, in fact. And I mean, it seems pretty appropriate. I mean, you have GVG, there's a lot of random stuff. People playing a lot of their own decks. I feel like it's going to take a lot of matches to really decide who's really the best player in a tournament at this stage because so much is up in the air. But I'm pretty excited. What do you think of the tournament? What do you think of GVG so far, Frodan?
Well, Crit, I'm not going to lie to you. This morning I was at rank 1, 4 stars. So I was like, yeah, well, real quick before the cast, I'll just win a few games and get into the legend. But I actually just lost 4 in a row, so I'm feeling a little salty at the moment. And I really hate the Zulok that has Implosion and Sea Giant. So if I see that, I'm going to lose respect for the player a lot. So I'm looking forward to seeing some cool, unique decks. But at the same time, I wouldn't be surprised to see a lot of the abusive ladder stuff that's been working. We have some of the strongest ladder players in all of Hearthstone here. Kalento, Tice, Faramir. Even Forsen's hit like number one legend multiple times. So I think we're going to see some really cool decks. And I'm looking forward to it, man.
Yeah, Forsen's been doing really well. Not anymore because it's not a thing anymore. But in the past, I think when he actually got number one, it was Miracle Rogue. I think every time.
Yeah, and that's right.
I think that was his go-to deck. And I don't know what he's got now. Some of these players must be a little bit distraught here with so much changing. Because, I mean, we've seen, maybe not exactly card for card, but the same type of deck kind of survived for many, many months. And some are still going. Like, we still see a lot of Handlock, for instance, that's still played largely the same way, don't you think?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. They're sliding in cards at spots where they feel like it's really strong, like the Antique Healbot. Even the Recombobulator sometimes see play, but I'm not sure how people feel at the moment, because even though Handlock was the deck when GVG first came out, I think Zoo is really starting to make a strong comeback, and people are also experimenting with Demon Lock a ton, although I'm not sure if this is the proving ground. Maybe it is because the stakes aren't that high and you get to see it perform in a tournament setting. But at the same time, there still is a serious amount of money. There's $3,000 to be distributed for these 8 players. It only goes to the top 4. So these guys definitely want to win, because at least winning one series is guaranteed $500.
Well, because it is single elimination, I think people are going to play pretty safe decks. I think we're going to see a lot of, like, everyone's going to play some kind of Warlock. It's going to be Hand or Zoo. And I think you're going to see some of the other consistent decks right now. Like Warrior, for instance, is fairly consistent. And I think some of the mech, what would you call it? Zoo or aggro mage? Where you don't have much of a late game, not many spells. Mech mage.
Yeah.
I've seen a lot of that. I played a lot of that. I had a lot of fun. I like Echo of Medivh in that. And I don't see that too frequently. Actually, I don't think I've seen a tournament yet. But I think it's really good. I'm a fan.
Yeah, we've seen some pretty wacky combos with Echo of Medivh. I don't know if anyone's truly had the balls to go into at the moment, but I believe our first game is about to get started, Crip, between RDU versus Peeny. Now, Peeny is from Team Method, and he's a player that made a splash over at Seed Story Cup, where he was able to advance a lot farther than people expected until he got stopped by his own teammate. Do you know much about Team Method at all, Crip, from being able to watch or even play on ladder?
I know Method from World of Warcraft, and I have a lot of friends in there, because we used to collaborate when I played World of Warcraft. I ran one of the Hearthstone tournaments for them, but past that, haven't spoken to them too much.
Gotcha.
Well, we do have mech mage, and we have it pinned up against a pretty weird shaman deck. I mean, so far we're seeing big creatures, flame tongue totems, and crackle earthshock. I mean, at this point, this could be Ancestor's Call Shaman, right? It could be.
Yeah, you know, actually that deck is pretty nuts. If they ever get like Ancestor's Call in their opening hand with a big legendary, actually just sometimes win you the game. It's like unstable portal on steroids. I'm not sure how this deck will pan out though. I haven't actually seen even Trogzor play much in Shaman whatsoever.
Ancestor's Call Shaman is actually the first deck I made in GVG, and it was a bit of a disappointment. I actually only won when Ancestor's Call brought up Malagos, because then I'd use all my efficient spells to remove the board completely.
Okay.
Like, you know, I'd Ancestor's Call Malagos on like turn 5, and then I'd Forked Lightning, their, you know, their legendary, plus whatever was on the board.
Sounds OP, man.
The rest of the times you get slaughtered, though.
Well, as long as you win gloriously, it's okay.
Yeah. It does seem to be a more traditional Shaman here with the Haunted Creeper. It's a card that survived a very long time in Shaman. Just because, you know, you just want some kind of body on the board. Because, you know, even a 1-1, when you're facing a Shaman, you've pretty much seen a 3-1. And, yeah, it makes you overplay into it, I feel, more often than not.
I'm really interested by cards like Antique Healbot, because I know Shaman did struggle with healing for a long time in the metagame, especially because it's so good at stabilizing if it can line up with spells, but sometimes it just gets too low where it doesn't matter if you stabilize at a certain point in the game. So I'm curious if Artie is making this call because he's afraid of decks like Hunter or these aggressive mages that we've seen. I'm not sure how it works out, because so far it looks like he's getting bullied, like we come to expect.
Yep. Early game and mid game mech. It's pretty serious. The thing with Shaman is, like, even if you heal a little bit, it might you know, kind of be the decisive factor, but usually I feel that you just lose both on the board and in life at the same time when, you know, you just lose board control.
Yeah, it often can be the case. Where your board doesn't even, it's not even that impactful because you're just making small totems compared to these durable sticky minions. You have Pilot Shredder and Harvest Golem, which are basically synonymous with each other. They keep dropping these small minions. Lightning Storm needs to roll out, but look at what came out of the Pilot Shredder. It was a Haunted Creeper. So there's more sticky minions, and to add insult to injury, the Mech Warper stayed alive through the Lightning Storm. This is a terrible start for RDU.
I'm a little bit delayed. You're spoiling for me, man. I want to see that roll fail myself. Yeah, but I mean, it's exactly the point. Like, at this point in the game, the mage is gonna get out of control. The shaman's not gonna have a board. The shaman's gonna be very low on life very soon. I mean, you're gonna spend, you know, the turn after your overload to cast a heal and a terrible minion. I don't know. I don't see the spot for it.
You see like how this is starting to snowball. Like, how are you even supposed to get past this Annoyatron? You have such like high impact minions with Trogzor and Alakir if they're allowed to have their way. But when you have this 1-2 Divine Shield, and then you just have a lot of other minions just plucking away, and you also have Fireball as a finisher too. So that Antique Healbot's actually not going to be that much impact.
Exactly. Now, what do you think of Annoyatron? I've seen it run in a few mage decks, but not in that many.
Oh,
you like the card?
I really like it, especially in mech decks that can synergize with buffs. Like, I've seen Shamans actually even run that. And then they use Power Mace, and then all of a sudden you have this Annoyatron that's 3-4 Divine Shield. I've seen Rogues, like Tempo Rogues, run it with Iron Sensei. It's actually like, it's such an underwhelming card sometimes, and then also, it's just like the most broken Voidwalker you've ever seen. It's like Voidwalker times two. And I don't know. I've always been so divided on the card, but overall, I really like it. What do you think?
I mean, it seems to be working for some decks. Plain Arena, I haven't really seen it do too much work. It's hard to really line up those synergies there. In Ranked, I've seen it a little bit. I don't know. Thing is, I usually play very polar opposites. I play like the very Zooey deck, where you don't really care about a 1-2 Divine Shield. And I play like the very slow decks, with like hard clears, and you don't really care about a 1 attack minion, so.
Yeah. No, definitely. I think one thing that's good is that it doesn't go with everything, because even though it's got reasonable amount of like impact on the board, just sometimes it doesn't do anything. So I think the card's pretty balanced. If it was like any more impactful, I think it'd be overpowered. Like if it was a 2-2.
I also feel like a lot of shamans have dropped Voidwalkers. I think Voidwalker is slightly substandard now. There's just so many other good early game minions you can choose from.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I mean, how is RDU stabilized from this point? Gosh, I mean, even if he gets like taunt totems from this point on, he's in threat of dying with Fireball.
I mean, this is where Antique Healbot might give you another turn. But that's about it. Like, you're, like, the amount that it's healing, you're still behind the same. You're still gonna be behind the same on the board.
Well, he's got Hex, and he's got that emergency coolant to freeze, so it buys some time. Maybe he can bring out something else that can have high impact as well, but he's gonna really have to lever. Oh man. Method Beanie just picked up the Fireball and the Frostbolt combination. That's pretty nasty. Oh gosh, I don't know how you're supposed to catch up from here now.
No. I don't really understand the return play there. What was the point of that?
I don't know.
It just unfreezes the next turn anyway.
Yeah, and it didn't lose any health, right? It was just frozen.
I mean, since you floated mana, you might as well use it to heal the Mech Warper.
Right, and it would have cost the same exact mana too. That is really curious.
I think it would cost one more because the Mech Warper's in play, the Snowchugger had discounted one. But he floated five, so it's the same.
Good eye. Well, this is kind of annoying.
Yeah. A double Argus seems to be pretty relevant.
It does. I really wonder how much Trogzor can make an impact too, because it's getting to the point where the spells are just going to kill him anyway, so Trogzor won't have impact. Mm-hmm. And can RDU flip the switch fast enough? I mean, he's got some reasonable damage come the opposite way. I mean, a spell power totem and he rolls high on Crackle is a lot of burst, especially with Rockbreaker in hand.
Peony does need to draw it here. Can't actually see his hand this moment.
Yeah, it looks like we dropped him.
But the fact that he hasn't played it already. Oh, no! It's coming. He did draw the other fireball, didn't he? He did. Oh, this is disgusting. It has to be.
Is it Ice Link? Oh, no, second Frostbolt, it looks like.
Is it?
That from the far right.
Oh, it is. Yeah.
Oh, right. Wow.
Well, that's a lot of trods. Yeah. Well, those minions do have spell taunt, but not when you're dead. So that's a little bit of an issue there.
Wow, I really felt like RDU had a chance, just like a sliver of hope, especially if he has another antique healbot to put himself out of range.
Yeah, I mean, we trashed the card a little bit, but it actually is the only reason he was even in that game at all to begin with. Right. So, I mean, it seemed all right, but I just feel still that the biggest impact in that game was the Argus. And the healbot did its part, I guess, too. If he was any lower, the fireball would have just sniped him. So maybe there is quite a place for it. So we're not going to see that unless RDU wins 3 against Peony here.
Yeah, that's now, right. It's a best of 5. So
yeah,
Peony
best of 5
wins
with single elimination. Now, do we know what decks are involved in this?
As far as I know, I don't really see the classes, so unless they were given to you, I'm actually just going with the flow here.
All right. Well, we're gonna give them a minute to review their options here, and when we come back, we're going to see game 2 of RDU and Peony. Hey guys, welcome back. We're about to see game two between RDU and Peeny. Peeny took the first one with his mech mage, I guess we're calling it. And we don't have the classes for you guys yet. We're going to relay that information. We're just fixing a little bit of a mix-up there. And we just fixed it up here. So RDU was running Druid, Shaman, Warrior, Warlock. Peeny was running Druid, Mage, Warrior, Warlock. So RDU had the Shaman while Peeny had the Mage, and the rest of the lineups were exactly the same. And in fact, yep. They both banned Warlock. So if the Mages dropped from Peeny, we're basically looking at mirror classes, but with as much deck diversity as you've seen on ladder, I doubt there are too many similarities between the decks.
Yeah, and I think we already see a couple trends here just from the opening sequence of bans and picks. The first is that Warlock is so super scary. Strong at the moment, especially considering its single elimination. You guess wrong once, you're already at disadvantage in terms of what archetype is it. Second is the popularity of Hunter has drastically fallen, especially considering that so many classes have tools against it. You know, most of the players were telling me they think that Hunter's in the bottom triad of classes at the moment, maybe like sixth or, you know, even seventh best class at the moment. It's just so surprising considering how Hunter, even when GBG first came out, you still see a lot of it on ladders. So looks like the pros are on to how classes can fight against it. And we're going straight into game number two here with Warrior as a choice against his mech mage.
The funny thing is, in Arena, actually, I feel Hunter has improved a lot because it's so much easier to get crucial face cards like weapons. Like suddenly you have Glaive Zuka, which is almost on par with the bow in Arena because you're not likely to get secrets anyway. I mean, it's a two drop, it's a weapon. I mean, before you'd get a weapon in 100, you'd be ecstatic, and now I guess it's gonna be kind of the norm.
Until now, I think no one's complaining about not seeing Hunters in tournaments at the moment. Although this mage could quickly turn people's opinions because of how fast it is, how dominant it can be. Yeah. Warrior's one of the best decks at handling this aggression, although when cards like Snowchugger are out, that's definitely going to be a problem.
It's going to be a problem just against the weapons, but because there's no weapons, it should be okay. The main issue is that right now, because there's not any weapons, he doesn't have a way to stop the attacks from coming through. Now he does! There we go, that's a good draw. But the issue is that even if you top deck a weapon, you can't make use of it when you got the Snow Chugger beating on your face.
Right. Well, being able to pick off that Snow Chugger is pretty valuable. I mean, Peeny's plays are pretty straightforward. Just slam down whatever strongest minion you can, as well as being able to try to get some of these spare parts. I wonder if he's also running Antonitus into this deck. There's two different variations of the mech mage. One is Brian Kibler's, and one is a more lean version where Strifeco ran to his Kinguin tournament. Strifeco doesn't run the Antonitus, but Kibler does. And that's because Strifeco wants a lot more early game efficiency. Do you favor any type of deck at the moment when it comes to mech mage between these two decks?
The ones that I actually played the Antonitus before the Kibler does, and I think a lot of people have as well. Just because it's good synergy, really.
Right.
But the Antonitus one is just a lot cooler. I feel like you can outpace control decks even with that one. But when I play like the faster type of mage, I actually make it a little bit more faster than Strifecrow's.
Wow.
So, I don't know. I think the Antonitus one is probably overall a little bit more effective, at least from what I've played.
Yeah, it's definitely more balanced because you can scale into late game. I mean, this deck runs into the same problems as any aggressive deck where it can just fizzle. Like, if you get, you know, the Micro Machine as your top deck late game, that's not exactly the most appealing thing. But I mean, look at some of these spare parts too. They are pretty useful ones. I like having a lot of the abilities to swap health. So the reversing switch is good against taunts.
I actually don't think there's much to do right now. Like, I feel like these freezes are pretty desperate. I feel like Peeny right now is probably trying to draw Flamestrike or something.
Yeah, the Sylvanas already threatens most of what's on the board. And then Dr. Boom coming out here already, like, destroys a lot of the aggro, especially with how much health Warriors had. This game has been pretty fast-paced so far, but the decisions have pretty much played themselves. Mage trying to swarm the board and Warriors trying to stop it.
Now, the Warrior's winning by a landslide right now. I mean, as the mage here, what can you really do?
Well, the problem is the possibility of even just like taking too much damage and dying, because you don't know if your opponent has like weapons to fill it up, and Dr. Boom threatens your board. Fireball and Dr. Boom. Wow, that's just such a big damage sink right there. That's 7 damage. And the fact that Sludge Belch is going to be taking away at least 7 more.
I kind of agree with that. I mean, in this position, you're not going to win by bursting your opponent down with spells.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it is at 33. It's a warrior with that board. Saving spells is a losing play.
Oh my. Well, RDU has Grommash in hand. He's got a death spite. So,
he's not going to have a Grommash in hand too long, apparently.
Oh! Yeah.
Thinking of playing it.
It makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, when you crush the board, you're really just in an extremely favorable position.
I mean, he's got such big threats anyways, that Grommash doesn't have to be the finisher. He just needs to stabilize. So it's much different compared to playing against a control deck.
I am funny. I'm actually surprised he played a creature before pinging the Boombot. That might be a misplay.
Nope, I think my stream dropped, Crib. One sec.
I believe mine did as well.
But yeah, you're right. Trying to destroy the Boombot will be really important, just because if it gets damage off on the Micro Machine.
Oh yeah, he played both creatures now, and wow, that's really lucky.
Well, all according to plan, I guess.
Yeah. Might get your own little Micro Machine. That's a pretty good thing. Now here, I guess you do the Alistraza. I feel like the Shield Maiden is just fine. Alistraza does set up for lethal though.
Yeah, he can kill him next turn with the Death Spike, which doesn't look like. Oh, he does have the Emergency Coolant to stop it. So stall it for one more turn. But is this any way to live, Crip?
Nah, I mean the Wire's 29 life. The chance the Mage wins right now is basically zero. Never actually zero. You never know when someone trips over a network cable.
Yeah, or if Peony plays Deathwing.
I think
both
that's gonna
are equally as likely.
And there's a big game there.
Deathwing's
not gonna
right.
do anything.
So I guess even if he has Deathwing.
The Blast Mage. That's. I feel that's really what makes the Mage what it is. Like.
Oh, it is.
If you're winning by a little bit, you Goblin Blast Mage and get a little bit lucky, it's just a blowout. That's the card that ends it. That's about as early as it can end in Constructed right now. Like, turn 4, you know you lose, and that card makes it happen.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's as if I just said, if Knife Juggler procced 4 times as soon as you played it.
Yeah.
Like, how insane would that be? And this scales accordingly with stats, too. So it's just it's just a card that's so crazy. Not to mention you have spare parts. Sometimes you get the reverser where you can allow to play it again. Like, you put it, or the rewinder, excuse me, where you put it back to your hand, play the Blast Mage one more time. It's just crazy, crazy effects.
Well, it is 1-1. RDU came into the matchup with the Shaman as the unique deck. Peony came in with the Mage. Both are down. So both players are basically down to Warrior and Druid. And now traditionally, Druid does do pretty well against Warrior. And I think that still kind of holds true. Like, Druids are still running the combo and Warriors are still running control. So, still pretty much a toss-up here.
I definitely think Druids, it'll definitely be Druid here from Peony, because that's what you want to line this Druid up. It's such a strong matchup still. Mm-hmm. People are running stickier minions, maybe some of the Pilot Shredders, or, you know, you even see a few Druids toss in a Sneasel Shredder that summons another Legendary after it dies, which is still pretty effective, and they replace, like, a Cairn, maybe even use a Sky Golem, too. So there's a lot of stickier minions that still fit the theme of having a Rushdown Druid with a lot of those token-esque things. So I wouldn't be surprised if it was just more of a Druid, just plug and play some GVG cards.
Well, we're about to see just that. I think we're going to get right into the next game. Now, The Druid's probably going to take this. I don't think it's that high of a favorite. I mean, other casters, other people have their own opinions, but from what I've seen, I feel like the Druid wins maybe, let's say optimistically, 65% of the time. But if the Druid wins, it's going to be Druid on Druid, and that's really where you have to roll the dice, I feel. Like, if one Druid gets some kind of accelerated minion, the other doesn't, it's just a very difficult game to come back from.
Yeah, the tempo snowball is actually pretty, is still pretty severe at the moment. With wild growths and innervates, you're absolutely right. I am curious to see if anybody of these players are running those new druid cards, though. I don't think anybody has yet found a real applicable use of Druid of the Fang or Tree of Life or even Dark Whispers, where you summon five wisps. I think I would be super impressed. I think if someone wins a game with Dark Whispers, they should just earn the championship right there on the spot. What
Okay,
do you think,
that
Chris?
sounds pretty good to me. All right. Well, we do have it here. We do have the possible turn one Yeti, but with the wild growth in hand as well, you can choose to save it. Right now, though, you don't really have any cards where you want to scale wild growth with innervate, though, because like if well, what you can do is you can coin out the wild growth, and then you can innervate out the Druid of the Claw. And then you can just play the Yeti.
Yeah, I do like turn one Yeti though still, because this is the most vulnerable time for Warrior, because they the only combination of cards is Whirlwind X to kill those with Yeti, and he'll always keep his armor down. Versus even on turn three, like even if he has three mana, he still can cool Taskmaster Execute. So if you're gonna use Innervate for Yeti or any kind of pressure, I think now is the time. This, I think essentially there's still no difference between putting out Shade, whether you put on your third turn through Wild Growth and you have 4 mana or you just have 3 mana. Because effectively it's still the same exact thing. You're not afraid of any of effect that will be able to get to it.
Well, that Yeti got pretty slam dunked there with the cruel task execute. That's about as efficient as it's gonna get.
Yeah, if Artie didn't have that, the game would almost be feeling like it's on the verge of being over. If Yeti can get 12 to 16 damage in, that's just too much to come back from. But thankfully, RDU has stabilized. And he's even picked up another minion to play. Like, the Armor Smith is annoying enough where it's going to force a reaction. And Druid of the Claw charging here is most definitely warranted, because this Armor Smith, especially behind a Sludge Belcher, can lock away Druid from ever having a combo finish.
Oh, here's the decision. Now you can choose whether you want to Sludge Belcher or Axe.
Ooh. Yeah, I think axing is okay, because if you Sludge Belcher, there's still so many easy ways for Druid to just deal with it, and then
Yeah.
the Druid of the Claw is doing damage twice over.
Well, there's Trogzor. RDU does love that card. I'm not too big of a fan. I thought it was one of the cooler cards out there, but when I actually started using it, it didn't seem that way anymore.
Well, one thing that is nice about Trogzor is half of Phoenix hands are spells, and if you can't build up like a strong board with a lot of integrity to fight, then Trogzor will actually be a legitimate threat to just start whacking away and controlling the board. And it is on curve, so I don't know if RDU necessarily has a better play on turn 7 than Trogzor. It depends on how he feels on the next couple of turns panning out. Gonna be pretty good here in this situation, I think.
Well, I feel like the Warrior's in a really good spot here. I mean, the Druid does have the combo and all that, but the Warrior's is on such high health. He has a premium hand. He's got the taunt. I mean, even if the taunt eats up the second keeper, you're still in really good shape because you have so many silenceable creatures in your deck that are just gonna be so annoying and so difficult to deal with as a Druid.
Well, he's really thinking about playing Swipe as opposed to Ancient of Lore, which on curve, Ancient of Lore is just so strong. And I guess he wants to use this to pressure. But then you can't even really attack with Shade because it just dies to the Fiery War Axe. I still feel like playing the Ancient of Lore would have been slightly stronger here, especially because now you're playing off curve and Ancient of Lore gets clunkier the next couple of turns.
Oh,
What do you
there's
think, Chris?
Trogzor. Well, considering the Trogzor is going to come down this turn, this is actually going to turn out a little bit better for Peony.
Yeah.
But in general, I do agree with you. I'm curious how much these players actually know about each other at this point. Like, you know, when you see people play tournaments with the same type of decks for months and months and months and months, and then suddenly everything changes, how much insight do you really have on a player? Like, you know, do you really know RDU has Trogs or in every single deck he's brought to this tournament?
I think it's really difficult to say. You're right, or even know what to play around, like
Yeah.
let alone expect. But what are you afraid of dying in certain scenarios? Because there's some wacky things which you're not sure about. One of the most common questions is, how do I trade with when I have Dr. Boom on the field? And then the question is, how do I trade when my opponent also has Dr. Boom? When both of you play Dr. Boom on turn 7, it's like, how do the trades actually supposed to pan out? Am I supposed to trade the Dr. Boom first? There's like all these weird things where people don't know the optimal play yet. So that's why it's like so interesting to see how these players are deciding based off their play style and previous knowledge.
I'm actually a bit surprised to see the Sludge Belcher drop. I feel like if you're going to play the Sludge Belcher, you would kill the Ancient of Lore. Because, I mean,
Right.
if you're hiding your Trogs or behind a Sludge Belcher, it has one health. That's pretty much the ideal case. Like, even if it gets Wrathed, even if it gets swiped down, you're still getting the mini Trogs
Yeah, that's
or
a good point.
Troglodyte.
Yeah. You know, even if the Trogdor was taken out, the only way you could have reached it was through this Keeper of the Grove, and then either use Keeper of Grove on Trogdor, then at least you know you have Sludge Belcher, you're gonna be able to harass and slow down.
It plays out basically the same way. Oh no. Having to go face apparently.
Well, he's got one piece of the combo. I
Well,
mean, next turn he's got
technically,
12 damage
yeah,
just from
technically he does
camp.
have kind of a combo.
Yeah. That's actually pretty humorous.
So many 5-health creatures. That's so difficult to deal with as a warrior. Actually, it looks like the warrior's gonna die at this turn.
Yeah, because there's no way for RDU to gain health. And that's going to be a
Yeah,
little
that's
bit
it.
overkill. Wow.
Yep, two over. You basically needed to get an execute draw off the acolyte there. Just miss lethal. Okay.
Oh, Peony. Oh, you know what? He got so enticed by this 10 mana fill out the curve that he got overexcited. I don't know if it'll make a difference, though, because there's still a lot of pressure, and he still has the combo next turn, too.
Yeah.
Uh-oh. I think
Yep.
he
Yep.
realized, Crypt.
That just happened. Well, I think if a brawl is drawn and you armor up Shield Slam, you can make it. Armor up Shield Block, sorry. No, but no brawl is drawn.
Yeah, doesn't look like it's going to be the case here. There's still enough damage, and you know what? Peony can still kill him even without using the second Force of Nature, so you don't show your opponent that you missed lethal. I think that's the most important thing right here.
I think it's actually really important to show that your opponent that you missed lethal. This is how bad I play and you still lost. Good luck in the next game type of deal, you know?
Well, I mean, this is Druid versus Warrior, so it's really tough matchup for sure.
Yeah,
It
but
looks like game 3 is going to go to B.
I think it's pretty important because like some decks don't actually run double Force of Nature. I don't think he's fooling anyone though. This doesn't look like a very change the Druid from what at least I remember pre-GVG. But still. Yeah, the information denial. You gotta win. You gotta take home the monies.
Yeah, I mean, it
Way to
is
play it.
it's effectively a best of five for $500, and it ramps up from there. So, you know, Peony's at a 2-1 lead, and he's already challenging one of the most winning players of 2014 in Hearthstone and RDU. He's really consistent, but he's going to need to pull a rabbit out of his hat with his last remaining Druid deck. That's going to be coming up in just a minute, guys. When we come back, we'll have potentially the conclusion for our first best of five. Stay tuned.
Thank you.
while I think of the future, I think of the men and machines. Friends and ideas and philosophy and spirit.
All right, so we're back. We're about to see the druid mirror between Ardu and Pini. And I'm curious if we're actually going to see a different type of druid deck from Ardu. In the past, Legion of Heroes of Cards, I have seen Ardu bring some very creative decks. I think in Heroes of Cards 2, I saw a Summoning Portal. Remember, pre-GBG, I saw a Summoning Portal in a Zoo Warlock deck.
Yes.
There's VODs. There's VODs.
Well, I'm kind of sad I missed that one then. I think
it got destroyed. It like lost turn six or something.
Well, yeah, no doubt. Oh, there's Watchers. Okay, I wonder if this is similar to the Druid deck Firebat ran just a week ago at Deck Wars. He played Ogre Brutes and Wailing Souls. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's a way for you to get really strong early board control and tempo, especially if you have Ironbeak Owl as a third Silence in the deck. I'm almost convinced he is playing Ogre Brutes in this deck, too. It's a really cool combination that when you surprise your opponent, it's the same as if you innervate out a bunch of big creatures.
Well, how much of a surprise is there when you see the Ancient Watcher down on turn two there?
Well, how about on turn three with an Owl?
Oh, how about turn four of the Wailing Soul? Oh,
yeah.
No. Okay. I guess you gotta take the four damage. It's still a race between these mirrors.
Yeah, for sure. Looks like Pini has to play a little bit slower. He just picked up Wild Growth, which is pretty unfortunate considering he just hero powered. And he might not get the time to play that Wild Growth for almost the remainder of this game if it ends really quickly based off the way the tempo has been going. You might end this game with a quick Savage Roar if Pini chooses to hold on to this Shade of Naxxramas.
Well, he's got the Innervate too, so if he does draw some kind of Drew of the Call or other charge, I don't know what else might be in the deck.
But, yeah.
Savage Roar is a combo card, and Innervate is, you know, going to basically be an extension to that.
Well, hold on. Let's see.
Fel Reaver. That's right. There we go.
That was another card, too, that I forgot. Such a high impact card if you just get the silences off.
Well, here you can do it. You can do Keeper, Innervate, Savage Roar, and just go totally face here. That would be 14 plus. That would be 17. You'd have the Druid at 4 health.
17 damage on turn 5. He's just going to plop down this Fel Reaver. Makes total sense too, and try and push for the damage. He's got Savage Roar, and fortunately for Pini, he does have the big game Hunter, but that he only has two more mana to work with. He still is in danger of dying.
Mm-hmm. And he might even be greedy and not attack with his Shade, which I think is going to cost him the game if he ends up making that play, because none of the other mana points can really be spent defensively. Yeah, actually, this game actually relies on him attacking with his 4/4 stealth creature, and those attacks seem very poor.
Does it matter if he kills off the 3/1 or the 2/1? Ooh, wow, Arcane Golem also was the next card.
That was one of those fun cards to combo in a bit, yeah.
Yeah, because now next turn if he had that, he would have had an Arcane Golem plus Savage Roar. All right, well, looks like Force of Nature being picked up here is nice too, because now he has a full combo, but that's still a few turns away.
Yeah, you save the full combo here. I think you just, you can Force of Nature just to clear out the board. For sure, a little bit more damage. Okay. And how much do you have
keep the Ancient
next turn? Next turn, your opponent has to play two taunts. Because you can silence one of them and Savage Roar for 8. And you can't heal on 6 mana as a druid.
This mid-range druid deck doesn't play taunts, though. I drew the claw rarely goes into taunt mode.
Yeah.
Especially in the mirror. I mean, he has to use Force of Nature to clear one of these minions.
That's a pretty good read, too.
Yeah. Well, he knows he can die to just swipe as well. Like, it's just as simple as, like, any 4 damage entity, whether it's Druid of the Claw, Swipe, or Savage Roar, was able to finish. I mean, RDU's still within that range. It's so close at the moment, and there's no way for Peony to be defensive other than just armoring up with his hero power.
No, right now the only way he can survive is using the other Force of Nature on the Keeper. Or possibly Wrathing for one and drawing the other Wrath or a Swipe. And
yeah,
those,
I mean, but
those
how much are you gonna
those
play
are just
here,
plays you
right?
don't make. Like this game is absolutely going to go in RDU's side.
Yeah, because I mean there's a lot to be said about if you're just spending every single turn barely living at 4 HP, use Force of Nature, you're effectively dead anyway, so at one point if he has it,
Way over.
Wow, what a quick game number 4. And this series has just been very fast-paced games. Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was a mirror match that RDU won here, but it's a very crucial one because now Peony has to rely on his last deck, which is the Warrior, which we saw was not really the best of matchups against at least the traditional combo druid. This Ancient Watcher version, however, I really don't know. Do you know if it actually runs double combo? I think that's a very significant part.
I believe Firebat ran one Force of Nature, but it had 2 Savage Roars. And the logic was that oftentimes, because you're flooding the board so early, you have the opportunity to use a Savage Roar, but the second Force of Nature might feel clunky.
All right. Well, I think we're going to take a short break before the players do get into their final match. And we're going to see Druid versus Warrior again, but not quite in the same sense. So maybe there's going to be some surprises then. So we're back. We got the Warrior versus Druid. What do you expect is going to happen here for Ren? I mean, have you seen this type of Druid in action against the Control Warrior? Because most of the Control Warriors are basically the same.
Yeah, it's nasty. Because there's so many targets that you want to early execute, like the Ancient Watcher, like an Ogre Brood. Even the Wailing Soul is like threatening enough because it kills your Acolyte in one hit. It like easily picks off the Armorsmith. So like, it just dominates the board. This druid is so threatening if it lines up perfectly. Now, of course, with any Watcher druid deck, the problem is consistency. Like, how often can you line up these silences? Even though you do have a lot of them, Will they even line up correctly? Like, will you get all of your Iron Beak Owls and Silences and not any of your legitimate threats? There is a possibility this Druid deck doesn't run correctly, or doesn't draw correctly, rather, and then ends up falling flat. And if so, of course, Warrior can just run away with the game. But I'm still going to pick RDU in this spot.
All right. Well, we'll have to see. I do know that I was playing like Watcher Priest for a while, and Warrior was the absolute easiest exactly for
with,
that reason.
With Silence?
They wouldn't know what to do with the Ancient Watchers, and you know, they just play small minions that I just, you know, get the Shadow Madness and have a lot of fun with. And you know, Druids have a lot of efficient removals as well, kind of in a similar similar sense.
Yep. Well, looks like we're going to go in straight into game number 5. And remember, guys, this is a single elimination. This is where it all comes down to. And Pini was up 2-1, but RDU looks like he is in a prime spot. If he could piece together a decent-looking hand. What an awkward set of cards.
Double
that RDU
shield
has.
Slam. My eyes are open. Oh, actually, Pini, I feel, has... both players have awkward hands. Like, double shield slam is just not going to work if you can't activate the shield slams. And like, even that creature, like a 3-3, that's worrisome. Because if you don't deal with that, then you might lose all your armor.
But is this what you want to use shield slam on? Definitely not. Yeah,
I mean, you can
like,
shield slam Cruel Tasks one for one and develop the board. Think of the tempo.
Well, I mean, speaking of the tempo, I guess, RDU can put out the Wailing Stone. Like I said, it's like a legitimate threat enough that you want to shield slam this too, but you know there's bigger fish on the table that you have to eventually fry.
Oh, there we go. That makes everything better.
Oh, well, looks like he wants to put out Lothab instead.
Well, that's not going to work quite as well. I mean, that was certainly the play without drawing the Fiery War Axe, but I have the Fiery War Axe. I mean, I feel like I can protect Lothab from a bunch of small creatures ganging up on him.
Well, yeah, exactly. I mean, it's so easy for Druid to generate a little point of damage. Even if you put out Lothab too, you're using the coin to grab the board control, which you can do anyways with a weapon, and sneak into hero power, which is pretty important, honestly.
With that hand, that armor is crucial. Force of Nature's drawn. You got the double innervate, huh? So if you are running the double Savage Orb, one Force of Nature, this is basically what you want.
Well, I mean, ideally you'd be able to put out some damage too, so that way your opponent wouldn't be at 40 plus life by the time you double combo.
Okay. Well, he leaves the board with Acolyte. Acolyte just makes it so you get that little bit more range, especially with the Cruel Task. He basically has a 6 damage range against 6 mana, which is probably going to be effective.
Yep, and this is a problem with the Druid deck that we were talking about. It's just that if you get things out of the order, you actually just... Like, if you get all the big creatures that need to be silenced, but you just don't have a silence, it's very weak. Or even on the opposite side, if you just get all the silences and situational response cards, it doesn't do anything.
Yeah.
Already you stranded at the moment. Finally! Something. Is it too late though? I mean, Warrior already has had such an early comfortable
beginning of phase of the game. With this much damage gone, I feel like it's one of those games where you need both combos to go off to kill the Warrior. And if you don't have two combos, I mean, that's a pretty bad spot.
I mean, he's picked up Shield Block for the Shield Slam. Using Gore Howl, you can just because, well, you already have so much life in a comfortable spot.
Mm-hmm. I feel like the only reason he's playing Gore Howl is because he has Shield Block and Alistraza, and that just gives you such a big bounce back.
Right. Well. This is assuming your opponent isn't just going to pick up 2 charges in a row. That brought RDU very close within striking distance over the next couple turns, but he still needs to pick up that Savage Roar. He could, hypothetically, if he picks up the Savage Roar, go for
and,
that 14
and
point
doesn't
burst
armor.
Plus double innervate swipe.
Double innervate swipe. But he's going to armor for sure. Who are we kidding? Ooh. We're gonna armor up some extra too. There's Bouncy Blade. I've seen some Warriors cut that, but I've had a lot of fun with that card.
Yeah, it's just not as consistent as you'd like it to be, especially against aggro decks on ladder. It's oftentimes like a 3-mana whirlwind.
Yeah. When I played that controller, I actually cut the Armor Smith, so like the first big threat would come out, and the Bouncy Blade would just like kill that by itself every time.
Good for you, Crip. Not many Warriors have the ability to think that they should even cut Armor Smith. Some people are like, no, it's just too crucial. Like, I know Kit Kats was thinking about it, and then Sho heavily disagreed with him for a while. And I don't think too much of it.
I just have to try the new cards. And I just like look at the list, something's coming out. You know, it's not like, right. Do I take out, you know, Armorsmith because it's not good enough. It's like, you know, you just look at the list, you gotta take two or three things out, and that doesn't make the cut against the other cards.
Oh, sure, it's just intuition then at that stage.
Yeah.
Well, you drew Ragnaros. You also have Alexstrasza to put on some pretty significant pressure. You might even two-turn lethal your opponent.
Yeah, I mean, if you do plan on playing the aggressive route, you have to play Alexstrasza. If you save Alexstrasza, you're basically choosing to use it on your own. If you're playing a matchup like against Priest or something, or you need damage, you'd absolutely never Ragnaros before Alexstrasza.
Yeah.
So this is very telling. Like, he wants to play as safe as possible. On the other hand, it's also, like, Alistar's is a very good card to combo with Gorehowl, because it lets you gain so much value from it.
That is true. You can always swing it and then bounce yourself back up to 15. RDU is really going to bank on, one, this Ragnaros missing the ideal target, and two, drawing the Savage Roar so he can finish out this game. But that is his last outer. He's going to brawl. Wow.
That's pretty ballsy.
That's pretty manly. I don't know too many people who would brawl in this situation when you have Ragnaros.
It does seem like it's the safest play though. It's just like losing your rag is such a big deal. What now?
Bouncing Blade? I mean, I don't even know the math on this, Crip. Like, what's the likelihood of killing off like one of the minions while damaging enough to be significant? I don't know.
I think if you're gonna Bouncing Blade, you want to kill the keeper first.
Yeah. All right, here we go. Brawl time. He is gonna be able to kill whatever pops out. And the medium result, the average result ends up happening. And RDU is, well, he's almost out of options here. Needs an Ancient of Lore to bounce back.
Not exactly the average result. There's no average result there. There's the good side and the bad side. And that was on the bad side, just slightly so. Not all the way bad.
So it was in the middle of bad, would you say? Nope. The average result of bad.
It's in the third quarter. Fourth quarter is really bad. Yeah.
Fair enough. Yep, Bouncing Blade here. Gonna work pretty well.
Yeah, 5 damage to mana. I think you need a body on the board. You have 2 Harrison at the very least. There you go.
The Spider Tank is very curious. Like, what does Spider Tank actually synergize in this deck, other than just having like a big, reasonable body at turn 3?
I don't know, man. That does look pretty, experimental.
I wonder if, like,
I don't know how much
slipped into
how much of an experiment is a 3-mana 3/4 vanilla.
No, I wasn't necessarily saying it's a bad pick. It's just interesting considering a lot of things technically.
So he cut the shades, right? There's no shade of Nax in that deck. Got the shade for Arcane Golem, right. And the Spider Tank.
Peony's the one who has the he's the one who has a shade next round, so you're right. Wow. Balls to the wall.
Warrior's gonna take this, man.
Yeah. Looks like Peony's gonna be advancing to the top 4, barring a catastrophe of the highest order.
I think I'd just play it safe, double Cruel Task here. Oh, okay. He's playing it really safe. He wants to draw into more armor as fast as possible.
Yeah, I think he wants to hit his shield maidens. He's ready to use his Alexstrasza defensively, but your opponent can only draw one card.
Yeah, there's no one card that does that much damage. I can see. And now he has to do damage or clear that board. It's basically impossible. There's absolutely no way that RDU is going to be able to take back this game.
That's going to do it. Game number five goes to Peeny, and he is going to be the first player into the semifinals, where he'll await the winner of Kalento and Tice. And I wasn't expecting that, considering how well RDU's been able to play over the course of the year. But it seems like RDU's still struggling a little bit from time to time. Just always going to the distance, but never being able to close that series.
Mm-hmm. Well, we did see some very unusual stuff from him, so I'm at least happy we saw that. Peeny was running more of the decks that we've seen already. And I don't know, I really feel like this early on, after a game shifting expansion, you just gotta play your own decks. It's just the only manly thing you can do. You can't just play Handlock and standard Commander Druid again. It's, oh man, no respect.
For sure. Well, that's gonna wrap up our first series of the day, guys. We have three more planned out, all quarterfinals. Coming up, we have Kalento and Tice, and then we have Lothar versus Hosty. And then Faramir versus Forces. Six great players, three great matches coming up for you guys. Stay tuned, good. We'll be back in just a few minutes.